Now, on BBC Two, we profile one of this century's most enduring aircraft, a flying museum piece that until last year was an integral part of Britain's frontline coastal defence system, the Avro Shackleton, in perpetual motion.
For 40 years, this aeroplane was Britain's first line of defence in the Cold War, a design that dates back to the 1930s. Shackleton has a famous pedigree.
It's gone! Look! My God!
The dam-busting missions which flooded Nazi Germany's industrial heartland in World War II made Avro's Lancaster Britain's most famous bomber. Developed from the Lancaster, the Shackleton was built for a different war, the Cold War, in which watching and listening replaced fighting and dying. Devastating surprise air attacks like the Japanese strike on Pearl Harbor had convinced military strategists of the need for eyes in the sky. From 1951, the Shackleton was the RAF's flying radar station, patrolling British waters in search of intruders above and below the sea. But in the age of Star Wars and exocets and automated war, this machine belongs to an era when operators did more than press the button.
I think all airplanes will bring out certain qualities. It is a challenge when it's not a good day, the weather's rotten, it may be dark, it's probably raining. You could have lost an engine and the wind's from the wrong side and it's your landing and it's been a long day, but you get it down on the ground and that is nice after you've fought. An approach in those conditions, and that is fun, yes. Afterwards.
On a bad day, when you do struggle with the aeroplane and struggle with the navigation equipment, you come back and there can be a great feeling of satisfaction, thinking, yeah, that was a job well done. Other days, perhaps you go to the bar and have a few beers and forget about it.
It is an ergonomic disaster. It's very noisy, of course, it's very smelly, it's very cold at the front of the aeroplane, but always, you know, suffocatingly hot in this part of the aeroplane because of the electronics. All in all, it's hard work simply being in it without even getting around to doing the work.
We're definitely not in the shiny end of the Air Force. Someone described it as being as ugly as a box of frogs, which it patently is. And It's such a unique looking aeroplane. I mean, as soon as you arrive anywhere in this thing, people sort of come out with their jaws hanging open and flatly refuse to believe that you fly an operational mission with this thing.
Well, chaps, my watch says time to go.
I very first met up with the Shackleton back in 1979, and I can always remember thinking how bright and neat and shiny they looked on the outside and what remarkably good condition they were in, until I climbed the steps at the back there and walked in through the rear door and got an incredible shock, because it looked like something out of the Second World War. There was no panelling inside, it was just, you know, the inside of the single aluminium skin, and you could see all the ribs and rivets and things. And of course, all the paint is very worn and chipped, and the seats are extremely worn. And of course, there's an immediate smell of hydraulic fluid mixed with a kind of smell of ancient leather.
We met a lot of ex-Lancaster crews, or chaps who had flown Lancaster during the war with the RAF and the Royal Canadian Air Force. And you feel a great affinity. These chaps will come up and they'll just want to touch the aeroplane, get inside, smell it and feel the atmosphere. And they say that although this is a slightly bigger aeroplane than the Lancaster, it's changed very little.
Crew enter common starting checks. Eng, nav, solid, taco, alpha.
The wireless operator, the mouthpiece of the Lancaster. The observer navigator, the wizard who finds the way. The flight engineer, a comparatively new rank for heavy bombers, but a great man in an emergency. The captain of the aircraft. Good luck to him and his crew. Good luck to them all. To the team that has done its job. To the team that is again on the job.
Complete. Crew chief start checks. Clear 3, switches 3, contact 3.
23.
Short pressure 3.
It gives a sense of quite incredible power sitting immediately behind those propellers. A 36-litre V12 engine, of course, makes an incredible amount of noise. It's always a little bit of a shock when it actually does kick into life.
Joined the Shackleton force back in 1974 and was put into the back of this thing. It struck me as being like a tin shed with somebody hitting the outside with very extremely large hammers, and that, in addition to all the noise from the radios and so forth, really had me quite boggled. But surprisingly, you get used to it quite quickly, and you just don't notice it after all.
Ignition, dead object, flaps, checks one up, indicating. Visually from the rear, restrictors working. Bomb doors, coast black. Engineers checks, complete. After starts complete. Supercharger.
Over here, 4%.
Flying control,
7-3.
Take off clearance, one to go. One to go.
The Shackleton, 10,000 rivets flying in close formation.
It's a nasty thing to say, really. I mean, I think most of us have flown this aeroplane, love it. I won't have a word said against it. I prefer to hear it called the old grey lady. It's a cracker. It's solid. It's a very solid aeroplane. Everything is quality built, and the manufacture will last forever, I think. It's a strange thing to say, but it's a lovely aeroplane.
The Shackleton story starts in 1936, when Britain's Air Ministry wanted a new twin-engined heavy bomber.
I started with Avro, A.V. Run Company, as an apprentice in 1931. In those days, the production aeroplanes were biplanes. We at Avro's had mainly concerned ourselves with welded steel fuselages, fabric covered, wooden wings, etc. And when we received the tender for a new heavy bomber, it had to be an all-metal aeroplane.
Air warfare was still a young science, and bombing a hit-and-miss operation, mostly miss. Dive bombing improved accuracy, but called for extra strong wings that wouldn't snap under the strain. New tactics pushed designs and designers to the limit. Fears that airfields and runways made easily spottable targets prompted experiments to catapult aircraft into the sky.
The catapult requirement enabled, in the case of the Avro aircraft, a very strong floor, which became the roof of a very large bomb compartment. In effect, that created a much stronger fuselage structure than you would normally have had, which was in the long term very beneficial.
Also of considerable aid to the Royal Air Force is the big twin-engine bomber known as the Manchester. These aircraft have been in service for some time, but pictures of them have only just been released. They carry a heavy bomb load at a high speed, thanks to the Rolls-Royce Vulture engines, and they have a powerful defensive armament.
Despite the propaganda, the Manchester was a failure. Its two Vulture engines were too slow, too unreliable, and too few. Avro's coveted the Spitfire and Hurricane's Merlin engines, but at the height of the Battle of Britain, there were none available for bombers.
Somehow, I hesitate to know exactly how we acquired four Merlin engines. You don't ask too many questions in those days where you got things from. We took Manchester fuselage components because they were identical. We took Manchester tail units and put them in the experiment shop. And in January the 9th, 1941, some 6 or 8 months later, we flew a Lancaster.
And here's a sight become increasingly routine, a Lancaster leaving the sheds for its test flight.
The flight of the first prototype Lancaster was excellent. Travelled well over 300 miles an hour, which was a considerable boost compared to the speed of the Manchester. The basic change that made the Lancaster successful was, of course, the engines.
Hats and coats go aloft out of harm's way at factories where they build the Lancaster. And I can tell you they're building plenty and building them fast. Every single worker, man or woman, realizes that the RAF is depending on them for Lancasters, more Lancasters, and still more Lancasters.
All bang on. Yes, everything's bang on.
Shackleton crews in the 1990s feel a close affinity with the men who flew Lancasters.
It must have been a horrendous experience to not only have to struggle with perhaps an aeroplane, which is very heavy with bombs, in bad weather conditions, perhaps coming back with the crew shot up, but to actually be shot at by fighters and flak and things like that must have been a horrifying experience.
First bombers have dropped their incendiaries and ringed the target. Each speck of light a blazing German building. Easy enough to realize the catastrophe, the concentrated chaos that is overwhelming the city below.
very, very cold, extremely noisy, lots of vibration. And then, of course, you have to add to that the stress of being in a combat environment. It's not something that I envy, I must admit.
Over 7,000 Lancasters were built, and nearly half were lost in action. Each had a life expectancy of 14 missions, or 2 weeks, but they were lethal weapons. Lancasters helped deliver the 9,000 tons of bombs that destroyed Hamburg in 1944. After the war came a new era in aviation, the jet age. Avro's giant delta wing Vulcan bomber was a leap forward, but the old technology was not finished yet. Cold War anti-submarine patrols needed something slow, and that meant propellers.
Remember the wartime Lancaster bomber? Here's an improved version of that old friend in a new role, the Avro Shackleton. For long-range ocean patrolling, there's nothing to touch it. She carries radar, depth charges, bombs, and special anti-sub equipment. The Rolls-Royce engines give the range and reliability to keep an eye on plenty of ocean. Flying with only one engine, the Shackleton keeps on keeping on.
Design of aeroplane is not a static being. It's far more economical to do developments of an existing aeroplane than start from a blank piece of paper with a brand new one.
Avro's used the same centre wing they had designed for the Manchester and Lancaster. The Griffin engine, developed from the Rolls-Royce Merlin, had gears to drive two sets of propellers in opposite directions.
You could, in effect, double the propeller area for the same diameter. So that left us quite a reasonable propeller fuselage side clearance, which enabled us to make a much wider fuselage, which was just the thing necessary for a maritime reconnaissance aeroplane, where the crew should have more room to move around and do their duties.
Coastal Command must scan the skies and search the seas. Their eyes reach further than ever in history. We now have the Shackleton long-range reconnaissance aircraft, flying further and staying aloft longer than any of her predecessors.
Finally, as the crowd surge forward along the mall on this day of homage to our young sovereign, 18 Royal Air Force Shackletons dip in salute overhead. And the balcony appearance by Queen Elizabeth and other members of the royal family sets the seal on this, the first glittering ceremonial of her reign.
Shackleton's duties were a far cry from the drama of the Lancaster's missions, but they still did their bit for Britain.
Coastal Command had an unusual assignment. From St. Morgan, Cornwall, they were to fly 1,000 pounds of letters and newspapers to HMS Bermuda at sea off the Azores, 900 miles away. 6 hours after the takeoff, they sighted HMS Bermuda, 150 miles northeast of the Azores. A pretty good piece of flying. It only remained to open the bomb bay doors and drop the canisters as close as possible. Bermuda's crew thanked Coastal Command for a job well done.
A Shackleton could stay up in the air for 18 hours, so crews were grateful for the slightest diversion.
Yeah, I don't think we're sufficiently VMC,
The one thing that the Shackleton has been famous for over the years is developing a standard of in-flight catering second to none.
Okay, 2,000 feet, but we're at the top of the
It's pretty difficult, actually, cooking meals for nine in an oven which measures probably about 8 inches by 12 inches by about 6 inches deep. But it's quite amazing what some people can actually conjure up in the galley.
A maritime navigator from the old Shack days who was transiting the Indian Ocean, eating his lunch when a bait beam dropped onto the table, and being slightly bored on a 14-hour transit, he said, come left, 60 pilots. And they proceeded on that heading for a couple of minutes, and then parallel track, right, 60 pilots. Right, 60 again, parallel track, and in his log he recorded, alter heading, avoid bait beam.
But there were occasions when Shackletons were flown in anger. Wing Commander Ted Donovan recorded his experience of the 1956 Aden campaign with his own cine camera.
That's me, and I'm briefing them. And it was really containing the Arab tribes by really frightening them with bombs. and even flying over them would scour them. So we were really carrying on what was always called a colonial precinct. It was a new role, quite different from anything Coastal Command had done. First, we used 60-pound anti-personnel bombs. That was really just a scatter raid to chase people back into the hills. Then when we bombed at Dunover, it was the most serious thing we did, really. Then we started using 1,000-pounders. That, again, was only to dislodge them from the hills.
By 1969, it was time to start phasing the Shackleton out.
The Shackletons of Coastal Command are now being replaced by the most advanced reconnaissance aircraft in the world, the Hawker Siddeley Nimrod. This is a special version of the Comet, already famous as a civil and military transport. Equipped with the most sophisticated detection equipment, it has a digital computer to predict target speed and position and maintain the course of the plane. The most formidable anti-submarine aircraft in existence, it'll probably remain so for many years to come.
There is no ceremony in the disposal of old aircraft. All the fine engineering overnight becomes a waste of airspace. Most of the RAF's 180 Shackletons were scrapped, but at the 11th hour, 12 were granted a stay of execution. Refitted with radar that dated back to the Second World War, in 1972 they went back to work with No. 8 Squadron, watching this time for Soviet aircraft. It was supposed to be a stopgap measure until Nimrods could be developed, but the gap the Shackletons stopped lasted 19 years.
The bizarre thing is that we've taken a radar that was designed and built in the 1940s and an airframe which was designed and built in the 1950s and we fly it in an airborne early warning role in the 1990s. The radar's older than the airplane in actual fact, and it's certainly considerably older than I am. It's all valve technology, of course, and therefore it's extremely rugged. It is a very rudimentary system. But at the end of the day, it is better than having nothing at all. And we are able to do a limited job, and we were able to continue to provide AEW for the UK air defence system, despite the problems on it. The pilots refer to us as the talking freight, and we refer to them as the drivers, which drives them absolutely mad.
Roger, read Mike Alpha 001, Bravo, Mike Alpha Charlie 40.
The blobs of light could be anything from an oil rig to an enemy aircraft. Only a skilled operator could tell the difference and report an intruder back to the National Air Defence Headquarters.
Now identified, Faker, intercept, identify and report, call sign 03, over.
Romeo 80, copied, will pass on to mission 03.
Roger, out.
The Shackleton's quarry was another propeller-driven veteran of the Cold War, the Russian Tupolev 142, known to the RAF as the Bear. But with the collapse of the Soviet Empire, the stopgap Shackleton outlived its war.
I've been told that the Lancaster was designed for an expected life of 90 hours. The engineering was adequate for that sort of life expectancy. As it transpires, given that we use the same basic engineering on this thing, it was more than adequate. We were certainly more than 90 hours out of these old beasts in the time. It was no-frills engineering, is what it came down to. But it was good engineering. It's the old British principle of building everything twice as strong as it needs to be. It's worked.
When we hear those amazing stories of how a bomber got home in spite of having been badly shot up, we know that captain and crew owe their lives not only to their own skill and courage, but also to the tremendously high standard maintained by the men without wings.
The aircrew break them, I suppose we fix them, but we have a good repartee with the aircrew, especially the engineers, because they like to know what's caused the damage in case it happens again, and we like to be able to show them what we've actually found, and 9 times out of 10 we can tell them.
During the war, aircraft technicians and mechanics and so forth, we didn't have that much time to train them, so you're pushing people out into squadrons at a fairly minimal level of ability. So you wanted things people could fix relatively easily. You didn't want to have to do anything too complicated with them. And the basic aircraft structure remains that sort of technology. The engines are rather more sophisticated, although to watch some of the guys working on them, you wouldn't believe so. Some of the tools involved look extremely agricultural.
There's nothing hidden in it. Everything that's workable on it is fixable. In other words, if anything goes wrong with most jet engines, you'll have to change the engine. In this case, we can actually change bits of it and hopefully get it back flying again.
If you start at the top down, the camshaft itself is a work of art. When it's washed and well, you don't need to polish it, it just gleams at itself. The engineering on it is terrific. Nobody can beat it. They've tried, but they've never been able to beat it.
The fact that you could bolt a 2-ton engine onto a plate on the front of a wing with effectively just 4 bolts hanging it on is quite astounding. It speaks volumes for the solidity of the airframe. If you go and stand alongside one of those wheels, get a real idea of the size of them and of course the weight of them. When you bear in mind that, you know, this aircraft is coming in to do a landing in very, very gusty weather, and right at the last moment a wing may get lifted and 40 tons crashes down on it from a height of possibly 6 or 7 feet, it has to take an enormous strain. It's an extremely clever design. And of course, when it retracts, everything is packed away very neatly, followed by the doors closing shut.
The high-tech Nimrod never went into service. Its radar failed to perform, and the £1,000 million project was scrapped. Britain bought American Boeing AWACS. For the RAF, it was the end of an era.
Shackletons of the Royal Air Force, which are finally going out of service in a few weeks' time at the end of June after 40 years of frontline action. And these last three have come down from RAF Lossiemouth this morning. So they come rumbling and fairly low down the Mall towards Buckingham Palace.
We were tasked to go and fly in formation with the new E3D AWACS, which is replacing the Shackleton in the airborne early warning role. And we were accompanied by 3 Tornado F3s. And we were having to go at full power, at maximum RPM, where the F3s and the AWACS, of course, were having to go quite slowly at quite high angles of attack to simply stay with us at what was effectively our maximum speed. But then the chase aircraft said, okay, thank you very much, Shackleton. You can go en route now, we've finished with you. And I sat in the nose of the Shackleton, watching the E3 and the F3s turning away and climbing and speeding up. And I couldn't help feel that that was symbolic somehow of our role. Yes, thank you very much indeed. You've done us good service and we were very grateful to you. Now, if you'd like to bow out gracefully and we'll just carry on with this gleaming new aircraft into the future.
Guys could put their hand on their heart and say, I really didn't enjoy flying Shackletons. We're flying Rolls-Royce engines and leather seats. What more can you ask for?